So yesterday you were kind enough to try to answer these few questions. They were kind of special in the sense that they didn't require telephonic kind of numbers, information, but just to get a feel whether you are following. And as usually, we got the Gaussian distribution. Some of you were very comfortable with all these questions and answered very precisely. Some of you left blanks. Not many, fortunately. But nevertheless, it's enough to let me know that it would be nice if you can repeat your things. So the first one, and actually instead of me, I would rather like to try to get you talking. First one. How do we force nuclear matters in the phase transition? The mini bank in the laboratory. Any volunteer? Should I volunteer you? Why don't you guys try? How do we force it through the transition to see whether it's theory, which we said we would like to test this experiment, whether the theory predictions make sense, whether they are testable, whether they can be proclaimed as a truth. Scientific truth. How do we do it? Guys, I've talked 3 hours about that. Any volunteers? Go ahead, please.
So simply speaking, we could just adjust compression to the system, yeah. So we have a higher particle density.
But you said very important system, right?
Yeah.
We're not taking hadron, we're taking a system, which is nuclear. Yeah. Now, why are you not taking atoms, but we're taking nuclear? Atoms are simpler, right? And we can make really ions out of them.
We have to accelerate them.
Perfect, because there will be no way to exercise force on them, right? We have to have an ion to be able to manipulate with electric magnetic fields. Perfect. So we have a two systems, they're heavy. We already set compressed them, and?
And then the density reaches a critical density.
Perfect. So we bring them to the temperature, which is already given to us for calculation. They tell us, to be today in Rob Pisarski lecture 154 minus 10. So we kind of know how far we have to press to get to the phase. Now question, how do we measure this 150 or 160 or whatever? As I said yesterday, in the final state you have just debris. You have number of particles beautifully spread around. But we need to somehow from this combination of the tracks to get information which is somehow related to the temperature.
Okay, you just
have to juggle your memory because I talked about it, but you obviously know it from your physics classes. We are looking for the particles which originate, right? We are working on their PT distribution, and then we are fitting them with the
analytical formulas.
Oh, I have to be here. Okay, looks like I have to be in this cage here. So, we have a parameter with interpretation of temperature. So we know where we are. The problem is that we would like to know whether we are taking those particles which we want to take, those originally, not decay, That's a different issue. That's a different issue. We'd like to think about particles which do not interact on their way to the detectors. Like, for example, photons, they are electromagnetic interaction only, so they are kind of immune to the strong interaction. So, we are done with the first one. We already have a prescription for mini bank. And actually, this question went quite well. Not very many people have had a problem with it. So, thank you very much. Number two. Is it enough to bring matter to atomic state to create formation of UGP?
Equilibrium also, it's not enough.
Very good, very good. So two conditions, perfect. Not, actually you are very, very, very cryptic with the answer to this. Very often you got yes and got yes or no. That's actually sometimes true, but I want to go to the more explanation. Exactly what I was looking for. You need this thermodynamic, you are using this thermodynamic approach, and you are using the assumption of the equilibrium. So you better have it, otherwise everything makes no sense. It's just like, you know, huge calculations based on the very weak foundation. You need to make sure that your assumptions are satisfied. Number three, and here was a problem that I think the least popular answer I got from you. Somehow I didn't explain it, I think, well enough. What we learned from Rick was that we got a fluid. Flow was measured. We thought that it's only for light particles, for light quarks, because they form this soup. First step, we saw the heavy, strange quarks flow. And we saw through the measurements of hyperons, omega's, phi's, they have a measurable V2. And moreover, we saw that this is still the same order of magnitude as V2 for the lighter quark, which is already kind of a surprise. But S quarks is somehow heavier than light quarks, but D meson contains C quark. It is elephant. It is just huge, masses of 4 compared with 300, or we saw at the previous lecture, UD10, 5, maybe tiny, almost massless. And here we have an elephant, and we see also that it flows. And still with the error bars, it's the same kind of flow as the lighter quarks and strange quarks. So it looks like it is. The system is thermalized with even the heavier quarks, like C quarks. So this is the main thing we learn from flow of these, that C quark is thermalized together with the rest of the soup, with the U, D, and S. And it is a little bit surprising, and I think it is a problem for some theoretical approaches, and I believe it will be revised and new theories will show up. This is the first time we show it a few weeks ago at Quark Mentor. We have this result since Hodge probes in China last fall, but that was with a huge error bars. We didn't have yet quite well systematic errors. The finest results we show only recently. So it is incredibly interesting where the B quark will flow. So we would love to go after open beauty, B mesons. Well, we don't have enough statistics. We have enough to know that problem flows with a different value of flow, but this is not yet to the point that we can claim result. So see, measurements of D flow have a huge impact on our understanding of the situation. Remember, it was not expected that C quark would flow in such a temperature like a drink. It is kind of expected the situation may change in LHC, because like a trip you have few C-bar pairs produced per collision, and LHC you have over 200. So it's two orders of magnitude. So it's a crowd, they may have a chance to thermalize. However, reaction is happening very fast. We are talking about TV of energy. So do they have enough time to thermalize? This is another question. As your colleague said, we need thermalization in order to claim to GP. So this measurement of D has a fundamental influence on our thinking about what's going on. The most important right now to go after B, and that is not going to happen anytime soon because we need to build new detector. With the present detector, it's prohibitively expensive to go over B because we will have to sit years collecting data. With the new one, it will happen in 2 years. 2 years of the RIP time, which is basically 30 weeks of running per year. It is expected to be on the floor in 21, 22 around. It may happen that engineering run, which take place before, will also collect the data. So I imagine in 423 will not hear about it. Yes, sir.
Yeah. we see that demons don't flow. But we saw also from your
from your lecture that the dimensions flow differently from with other hadrons. Is that intuitive understanding?
Not really.
So this B2 over quark constituents versus...
No, David. Hydro should work up to 1.52. It is not expected to work to 5. So you see differences going further on. Up to the limit when you expect hydro to be your preferred approach, it is consistent. Even error bars are not responsible for the difference because the differences are smaller than error bars. So up to hydro limit, it sits there together with the rest of the gang. Further on, first of all, errors are huge because you're going to high PT, there is not enough statistics to shrink this error. But it will not help us because this error is mainly systematic, not a statistic.
Did I miss this somewhere in the lecture? Then
where does this scale come from? What you call hydro scale, this one part?
You say well, if you use a hydrodynamic model, would you be going with this to the very high PT? No.
On the other hand, you make this argument that everything flows, the soup flows, and also charm flows with it. Why does charm flow nevertheless different with the soup?
So what we are seeing right now, that to the level 1.5 GB, 2 GB flows the same way. What further, I would leave it open because of the error bar. Presently, you may say it's going lower. But again, as I said, this is not enough yet to claim that errors are of the physics.
It's not excluded that better measurement
right.
fall on the same
if, system. If difference is there is 1.5 sigma. Yes, sir.
Is it possible or
do you expect that for lower energies, for lower collision energies, this dimension flow will vanish because like C is not produced.
For lower energy, what?
This dimension flow would vanish.
In the sense, yes, you need energy to produce C quarks, right? So the cross section is rising nicely with the energy, and also it's rising nicely with the centrality. You don't produce that in peripheral collision, only central. You need a lot of heat to build that mass of 4 GV.
So there is a threshold for the deep flow in the centrality.
We have measurements for the meson only for 200 GV.
Okay.
It's not enough statistic. Cross section is relatively smaller. This low energy.
And if I make non-central collisions, then this dimension flow is gone.
It's 200 GV flows like the rest of the threads around.
Okay, but what's the centrality dependence?
So we have measurements only for central events. We have data for less central collisions. It's not analyzed yet. As I mentioned to you guys, you can make a multiplicity and believe that we are measuring very central events, it's not well defined. You kind of do it post-mortem. You take broader range and make your own base of comparison with global, you set your limit in B. For the moment, we have much more than one beam. We analyze and assess systematic errors. Systematic is main problem, not the statistic. To the central beam, the rest is waiting for next student. Yes, sir.
So we are talking about centrality. You say you measure this B value, impact parameter. How do you measure it, and is it really accurate?
No,
accurate enough to determine the centrality?
This is a great question. This is a pain in the neck. We are not measuring B method. We are not measuring impact parameter. We are estimating impact parameter comparison with model. Most popular is global because it's kind of accepted. What you do, you measure multiplicity in an experiment and you have global multiplicity and then since it's model, you know everything. You know this multiplicity corresponds to this impact parameter. So you are comparing both.
I have multiplicity,
let's say 500 and I look, global says it is range between 4 and 5. Affirming. So this is the way we assess impact parameter with experimental data. Not ideal, the only way we know.
Yes, because multiplicity could fluctuate too in principle.
Multiplicity
could
fluctuate, there is no rigid limit between interval. Usually you have a kind of murky way, so if you say plus minus half, keep in mind at least 25% of each time. So there's no rigid limit. Impact parameter is not well-defined variable.
Yes, what about and measurement of forward energy? Can you make it and determine centrality from it?
And or what kind of energy?
The forward energy. I mean, you can, in principle, measure the ratio of the energy that went.
You're talking about the calorimetric measurement.
Yes.
Exactly. Yeah. If you have a calorimeter which is long enough, you are fine. You are in safe zone. The problem is if your calorimeter is not big enough and some particles do what we call punch through, they are faster energy that calorimeter can contain. And some fraction goes away. You can do simulation and assess how much, but that's also not a very clean way. What you really do, as I mentioned to you before, simulation. From simulations you know you have such energetic particles, you know what the radiation length, you
design detectors,
and then you allow at least 25% to 50%, depends how much you can afford. Very hard, very sensing how much you can afford in hard currency. Calorimeters are very expensive. Average calorimeter is $20 million. So how much you can afford, you build bigger ones that simulation tell you, and then you're probably safe. This is what it's not possible of a stress importance of simulation. When you go for experiment, you really have to know what to expect. And then you position yourself in the safe zone. Otherwise, the information you obtain is not reliable. Measurement, coming back to measurement calorimeter, is very precise. What you do, you have usually this sandwich calorimeter. So you have a sandwich of the lead, which stops particle, absorbs energy, and then you have a crystal or scintillator, which catch a light. So you know how much it slows down, you read how much is there, you again slow down, you read, and you simply sum them up with a proper weighting. I think this is a very reliable measurement, and usually resolutions, the worst one is on the level of 17 to 15%. But our calorimeters right now are on the level of 10%, so it's a really good measurement.
Can you use calorimeter?
Can I use what?
Can you use a calorimeter to measure number of spectators in a collision and then confront it with the Glauber model?
Spectators?
Yes.
We have what is called 0-degree calorimeters. They are on the direction of the beam. They are catching neutrons. Protons are bended in the field. Neutrons don't care. So they go straight, and they tell you see peak, one neutron, two neutrons, three neutrons, and here I'm already cheating, because you never see four or five, but you should, because background is such that you are not seeing feather peaks very well, but this one, two, three is good enough to know how many goes there. But we are always skeptical, so we have this information, we'd like more. So we have another detectors in the forward direction, and they are also catching particles. But measurement of spectators in collider mode is not very easy because protons are bending and neutrons going straight forward. But you have independent information.
Okay.
We also trigger on it, means not star, but the experiments which trigger on it. We feel in star that this information 0 degree is not precise enough, but our experiment which has a 0 degree calorimeter very well segmented, and they trigger number of neutrons going forward, number of spectators going forward. Okay, can we go to the next question? I think we finished on this. What do you mean by penetrating probe? This also didn't do extremely well. I think like maybe 70-80% of you doesn't have any doubt, but I worry about the 30%. So let me go back to penetrating, as I mentioned, we do this artificial distinction between medium, which we would like to measure, and depth, which we used to measure. It's just like I mentioned, bucket with water. I put thermometer there, and I know it's plus, 22. right? But I really don't care about this thermometer. It is only a tool to measure what's happening in the bucket. So this is my probe. It has to be different than the medium, because otherwise I will not be able to measure, and has to provide information which is useful for me. If you remember with the jets, they are produced in the excited nuclear matter, and they're going outside. They are losing their energy. Weight, this lost energy, is something we would like to measure. We would like to know how much is for the medium. And then we transport coefficients from there and other interesting things. So penetrating probe is your thermometer. It's a tool which used to address questions of the media you are investigating. And it should survive to your measurement, right? We don't care if you have information that so did I turn that off? No.
No, it's working.
So, penetrating probe is the one we use to answer features, information about the medium. And next one is my jet favorite topic. What is jet? And it is, again, very different than we have in the normal everyday language. Jet is your window to look at a photon. Photon, due to the confinement, is not ready to show up to us as it is. You have to find a way to look at it. And this is just, you are looking after jets, which are a result of fragmentation of the photon. If you will know all particles which are part of the jet, and you will sum up their energy and other features, you will have that perfect information about the particle form. This is the only way, the only handle on the particle. So in the sense, jets are extremely important, and not because they are jets, but because they are this ideal probe. So physically, jet is a spray of particles, and this is very cute because many people just draw me a brush. This is jet. It is precise. Tells me only that I didn't formulate my question precise enough. But remember, the main thing is just what we expect from this. This is information on the particle which was created during collision. And it is the only information we might have. So this reason jet is such a huge field right now, because we are investigating particles in the different stages of the collision. So jet is not interesting by itself. It's interesting because it's a product of the particle fragmentation. It's your way of going after particle. So if you keep in mind jets equal particle with the sum, so all component, then you are fine. And this drawings is a brush, it's also fine. And we come here to kind of experimental question, to the last one. And it was very interesting, because some of you really enjoyed this question, and I got a very precise information with the description of the detector which sit inside and sit outside, and some of you ignore it, as probably serious tends to do, and or left it blank, or said, I don't remember. So please let me to repeat to you. When you do measurement, you don't want to manipulate information. So when you are close to the subject, you would like to preserve information which principles are available in the vertex. So detectors have to be thin. I said detect, not deflect. If you put a thin detectors, you can do corrections and kind of gauge what was there. If you have a very thick detector and there's a lot of DEX, a lot of losses, a lot of change of the temperature and direction or whatever because of scattering, your corrections are so huge that you stop to believe in them. So your idea of measurement is a little bit different with a big thick detector and a tiny thin detector. When I start to work on silicon detectors, we have had the detectors of 250 microns, and we felt they are very, very thin. I remember in the lab we almost stopped breathing because we wanted it to break. And right now we are making the detector of 50 microns. Fantastic, five times less. It is how technology is becoming more and more advanced and friendly to physics observers. So in a part, you would like to disturb as little as possible. This is philosophy. Then other part, you don't hear anymore. You want to catch everything. There is nothing behind that you would like to preserve information for. So we are putting all these huge calorimeters, they are tens of tons, and you are catching all particles. So inner part, cinnamon, outer part, big, massive, heavy one to contain all information. To this inner detector, outer detector is my way of seeing that, but I thought it's kind of intuitive, it would be easy to remember. Inner part, you want to measure as much as you can without any distortions. So sometimes you may give up on certain things because you don't want to impose modifications. And once you have this information, you can afford to destroy everything in order to get full information on energy. Okay, more questions. First, let me ask you, do you know why we didn't build the RIC? 200 billion investment. Why did we build a RIC?
What is billion?
200 million. Million. Billion. Billion is million in Polish. I don't know how many. No, billion is 10 to power 9. That's a billion.
Yeah, it's a billion.
It's a billion. So we built it to discover quadrupole plasma. That was the main goal. And we did it. Now, question, why did we build LHC? Not for heavy emphasis.
To find Susie.
What do you say?
To find supersymmetry.
To find Higgs. And we did it, we already have Higgs. So in the sense we can feel very successful. Supersymmetries are clearly in the same way. We wanted to understand why mass is what it is. What is a mechanism which assigns mass to particular particles? And Higgs mechanism was the one which was considered responsible. The only thing we are missing is just Higgs particles. Do you guys have any more questions? If not, I have a surprise for you. I have a short lecture, very tiny one. I think I have still 20 minutes. Is it correct?
Half an hour.
How many?
Half an hour.
Super.
It means so, 20 minutes.
Fantastic. So I have a kind of surprise for you. In America, in States, we teach students how to present, how to write publications, how to be successful on this area, and then you have to pass your information to somewhere else. Such a course is not offered here, I don't know why. I gave this lecture some time ago at the Technical Warszawska, it was very well received. I found it on my computer, and I thought, with the blessing of the chief, that I will show it to you. Yes, Dave.
Before you start with this, so I support, of course, that we do this.
Of course.
What was the conclusion from your last remark? Should I take from this? So with this billion investment that we have invested and we have found the goal, so should we now go to other topics?
No. There's no conclusion. I think it's a wonderful thing. The theory was able to predict things which experiment went and funded. And on the end, you find many other things around because it is much broader spectrum, right? Heavy ion physics was not the main goal on LHC floor. And now we have a very big spectrum of results from ALICE, from CMS, from ATLAS, etc. But for me, it was just, you know, to bring to your attention that you guys, theorists, are predicting, then the experiment comes and finds it. And this is wonderful because usually we are dealing with postdictions. And in this case, they have a prediction which will demonstrate its experiment. No any further conclusion. So this lecture will be about how to give a presentation. And usually when you give a talk or write a paper, you would like people to listen, to read, to follow. Why should you care? No, you need to know your audience, how to tell a story, how to write in a simple way, and conclusion. That's basically a very short run through the content of this presentation. So why should you care how many people listen to your presentation or read your article? Good presentation increase probability that your work will be understandable, that referee will write a good report, and you'll get good acceptance when sent to that person. Pretty important, pretty valuable. People who listen to your talk, read your paper, will hear your ideas. So you'll get a credit in a community, in scientific community. Will be some citation to your work, publicity, writing, speaking innovation, invitation, and on the end job offer, something what is very important as well. The alternative, and this is just a real thing, I cut it out from real reports. First one, physics measurements reported in this letter are important and interesting, and as well as being unique and apparently correct. However, the letter is currently written falls short of PRL standards in terms of communication. The abstract introduction conclusion do not present a clear message to heavy ion physics, and so on. Even reading the entire paper did not help. It is just a piece of editor letter to us from PRL. PRL is particularly tricky. They have a strict rule how many pictures, how many pages, etc. But the essence of this is pretty clear. And of course, it is this report is, as I said, this critic is sufficiently adverse that we cannot accept your paper based on the material now. So what's happening, we have to rewrite. And usually it's much more work to do it twice than do it once. So why don't you do it first time right? It is important to whom are you talking to. What is your audience? What's the level you can expect? How much people already know? You need to be able to communicate. So just it pays off to know exactly who you are talking to. And it will be different level. If your colleagues, referee and editors can't understand it, that is very clear that this paper will not go any further. The few word experts in the field will listen to you, and no matter whether this paper is good or bad or different, if necessary, they will know where to go and find the answer to the question you cannot answer. But most people, however, do have a choice. If your paper presentation is comprehensible, they will stop listening and wait for Reader Digest version, which will happen very soon or later or maybe never. But they will not make intellectual effort to try to go through it unless you really provide information they are looking for. Editors, conference, program, community, faculty, at places you might work, all fall into this category. So you need to be aware of it. Just the better you prepare, the better your chances. Do a clean analysis. This is very important. Keep things simple and unified. In America, it's very unkind abbreviation of this point. They call it KISS. Keep it simple, stupid. And this is a rule which students know from the very beginning. You have to have it simple and clean. Even if it's not necessary for physics, it really simplifies the writing. It helps you keep it simple and to the point. A presentation of paper with three different sets of cuts for three different analysis, it's difficult. It will clearly raise a red flag. It may be still okay, but it's presented in a way that is difficult, and believe me, you don't have a good chance of acceptance. Readers will wonder why, and they will be thinking that, you know, perhaps I'm hiding something. Tell a good linear story. Good physics presentation is like writing a good simple story. Follow a simple, clean linear thread. Many threaded Russian novels are hard to read. It doesn't have to be convoluted. It has to be just straight. Arguments after arguments with justification. Too many side points, too many detours are not good. It just probably got really lost. Physics is hard enough without the additional complication of multiple interlocked plots. Start with a clean introduction. Now I will go through the paper. You probably think one should start from abstract. We will get to the abstract at the very end. Because even if you write abstract at the very beginning, there's a good chance that you will write it after your paper is written. It's good to have a roadmap, but while you are writing, things will change. I think more often than less, you will write abstract from scratch. So we start from introduction. Set the context for your work. Something that is interesting and why readers should care. Explain the puzzle that you work on solving. For some work presentation papers, it may be worth pointing to why people in the field should care. You can relate to other fields which deal with the similar things. You remember yesterday we talked about plasma in lab, but we also told the plasma to place in very early eight stages of our universe. So you do this cross comparison and it's helping. The level depends on your target journal. If you are writing to science and nature, which is kind of popular, think about the graduate student in science, not necessarily physics. If you write PRL, that's a high level, think about graduate student in physics. If you write PRC or PRD, this is just much lengthy paper where you are allowed for many pictures and explanation. Think about new graduate students in particular physics. Those introductions and detailed description of the methodology will help them to get fluent in the language you are using in the other papers. And here I have examples of good and bad, and this will be posted. You can read at your convenience. You will know immediately what I meant by good and bad. Now, let's go to the analysis. We are done with the introduction. You already told your reader why they would like to read it. Remember that very often people give up after reading the first one paragraph introduction or abstract. So in this case, you don't want to lose them. You would like to present it the interesting way that they would like to follow. Now we go to analysis. Describe the detector, maybe, but you also can refer to the previous paper if this is not the first time where description is provided. You may have some new paper in your sleeve to refer to. You don't have to include in every paper. If this is already on the market, save your time and save your space in the pages. Describe the data set, and this is very important. Even the detector is described, you have to say everything you know about the particular conditions this data was taken with. Trigger is the main one. But you also have to say about number of triggers, perhaps some problems. When you talk about TPC, you often see the remark that certain readable didn't work, so we have a problem with the efficiency in particular phi area, and this is corrected with a 5 or 7%, something like that. It is very important because it just tells you how you look at the data which is going to be presented soon. Describe the data selection. This is very important. Different physics apply to peripheral, different to central collisions. You have to tell people up front, I am going to deal with central collision, or I'm going to deal with a low production if in ultra-relativistic peripheral collision, etc. They will just set their mind to particular areas they are interested. You need to tell them everything: centrality, event cuts, track cuts, efficiency. How did you analyze the data? The way analysis performed influence result. There are no question about it. And if you are talking to seasoned reader who does have experience, he wants to know. Differently you look at calorimetry data, differently you look at the tracking data. You have a detector which takes data with 50 kilohertz, 50,000 euros per second. You have a detector which takes data with 10 hertz or 20 hertz. When we are running low energies of MGV, we have like 5 hertz. Nothing. We're sitting and basically waiting for the new event. So different. And that's important that you know when you go further. And I think here, this is much clearer, you've done a clean analysis, goes without saying, right? Now you need to discuss your results, and this is extremely important. Separate your results from your interpretation of your results. Very important, don't mix it up. This is the main problem we have. You are trying to tell them how much you know, and really you have to tell them what is measured, and this is rock solid. And then interpretation is something which may change with time. So don't mix them up. Separate your result from interpretation of your result. Theories change with the seasons like a fashion. Fashion, you may not like it, but if you look back, it is true. But data always stays. What is measured. Rock is really solid. Experimental analysis takes much longer than theory papers. You want your paper to hold interest long than the theory papers that inspire. Well, it's questionable. I know that I'm talking mainly to theories, but this is the way things look from outsider. As much as possible, as separate your data from theory. It is very important to try to interpret, but to make a clear line between what is measured and what is inferred from the measurement. I think you describe your data in simple terms. I was talking to somebody here on the poster, you are using Fermi variable, which is not defined on the poster. The question was, why don't you use square root of S instead? Or at least define Fermi variable in something that is more popular, like square root of S, energy center of mass. Just do such a thing. It's much easier for the person who read your poster or work. Be clear about exactly what you are measuring. Tracks in such a PT range, you find mean PT, but in this range that will clearly influence your value of mean PT, and things like that. You would like to basically tell all this kind of kitchen type of information that they can help other people to follow what you did. Don't think it is too trivial. It's important. In English they say, devil is in detail. You need to know details to appreciate work, but also you can have a much deeper and better understanding if you know details. Now discuss the uncertainties. We know that the errors are very important. Remember, you don't have as a theorist to push your lines through the middle of experimental point. It's an error, and with an error bar, all information is equally important. Don't push your lines through the dots. Error around is substituting information through all this bar is the same. Present statistical errors, present systematical errors. Systematical errors are difficult. Experimentalists usually spend 3 times more time on assessing systematical errors than analysis. We are extremely honest and extremely deep in these calculations, you'll be surprised how much work it takes. But on the end, you get information tells you how serious you take this information. And that's very important. We have many errors, many sources of errors, and we are trying to separate them. Very often in the paper you see a table, and you have a list of sources of errors and percentage. On the end is a sum. This is my overall systematic error. But for some analysis, certain things are important, other not. So we have such a table with single out things which are important for your calculations. How much systematic errors affects particular measurements is very important. And sometimes you are not able to find the last word on the subject. So giving this information, it equips theorists who look into data to take what he needs for his calculation. You often show the errors together with your results, it's integrated with the results. I don't know if the is a good word, I don't know why they use it, I would say you show them together that you have very clear picture what is referring to what. Of course, interpretive results. You don't want to measure PT equal 4.5. You would like to know what you learn from this. What kind of physics picture is behind? We don't have a better way of understanding heavy iron physics than to rely on models. We build a model, we look at the prediction, we measure, doesn't work, we correct the model, we change things, look at the prediction, doesn't work, it's an interactive process. We learn about what's going on through the models. Interpretation is extremely important. And you may try to compare your data with existing theoretical calculation. This can be tricky. Be clear about the experimental and theoretical uncertainties. Very often you see the model and the band around. They also have uncertainties. Measurements are different meaning, having different meaning models, but because you have parameters, they have errors, they introduce, they impact your model, you can see the band uncertainties. And there are models which have bigger uncertainty sleeve around the current and experimental results. So it's an effort from both sides, from experimentalists to have a better handle on errors. We usually do it by the better statistic, more sophisticated detector, and from theorists to change this band around the model to shrink it, that is more concrete and helps to compare with experimental data. Be sure that your data supports what you say in the paper. It has to have one-to-one relation. Do not overinterpret the data. It's really good to be careful with the strong words, and you may say things like it is consistent instead of it is described by the model. You have to be careful. It's not good if you are trying to sell results with particular interpretation too hard, because you are influencing as if it was thinking and not necessarily correct. As we said, theories are getting more and more sophisticated, models more and more accurate, and this is simply changing. You need to compare with, I put here simply theoretical pictures, you compare with all theoretical pictures which are around, and you just show how close or how far away it is. Speculations are not really okay sometimes, but make sure that you clearly label as a speculation. Don't over-interpret or don't over-sell it. And here's an example, a text set. Comparing the distribution shown in figure 2a to 2d, we observe that scale balance function, which is done paper, changes significantly in shape and amplitude with the transverse momentum of finite third particle. It's very clear. We show that it's changing amplitude. We show that it's changing slightly shape. We are not over-interpreting. It will come later on. But here is the description of data, and this is very accurate. Keep this way. Now we get to conclusion. The most important, it is just good to have a because, as I mentioned to you, very often people read abstract and decide whether they like to read it, but sometimes they extend it to reading abstract and conclusions, and then they decide that they want to invest half an hour, 1 hour, or whatever is needed to go to the paper. Your conclusions have to be really well thought through. Conclusions are placed to recapitulate on main points of the paper and repeat the message that you like the reader to walk away with. It is not a point to introduce a new theory or new model. You cannot say in conclusion, I observe AB, therefore it fits this and this model. This is too late. It has to be in the paper. In conclusion, you are not doing comparison with the model. You are stating the result of this comparison, if that's applicable. And acknowledgement go here. It was to acknowledge people who help you. You cannot acknowledge anybody who is co-author with you. Write the abstract, as I said, it's practical to write it on the end. You may start from it, but it's very clear that you may have to rewrite it. Abstract is a small advertisement from the presentation of the paper. So you have to say why it is important, You have to show main results, not show. You have to mention main results. You have to tell them, I observe elliptic flow of the meson, or we observe a elliptic flow of the meson bigger than zero for PT, bigger than OPP, smaller than, just the bottom line, not a description. And don't overpromise. Don't make a statement which are not warranted by the data you will present, only to attract audience to read your paper. No language. Language is important. Physics ideas are hard to understand. So if you make your language very difficult, very complicated, it adds to the problem. Keep writing simple and clear. No more than 30 words in one sentence. And this is important. I am doing referee reports quite often, and everything is in English. But I immediately, when I see, for example, papers which are coming from you guys, from GSI, main authors, they are very long, and all verbs are at the end. I have a feeling I would take a scissor, cut these verbs and place it in the proper places. Try to keep the sentences. It is very important, it's very referee and future readers. Check spelling and grammar. It's very good if you have a native English person around who can go over it. Only one subject per sentence. Don't try to make in one sentence all possible conclusions. And here I have a few examples again. In your leisure, please go through it. You will not have any problems to find out why I pick up those. If you are having five topics in the same sentence, this sentence lasts five lines, it is no. It's difficult for you, it's difficult for reader, and it's very difficult for unprepared audience. Again, as I said, experts will know what to take from it, they will know what to get to answer their question, but not prepared audience will pick up, and you don't want that. Graphics. Choose careful to support the text and illustrate the points you want to make. Make sure that they are easy to read. Access clearly labeled, fonts large enough. And also you cannot have too many curves on the same picture because it's very hard to make sense out of it. Usually not more than 3 to 4 curves. Don't make a picture with 20 curves, please don't. It's hard. Choose symbols that are easy to tell apart. You cannot have a gray and very gray on the same picture. It's print, but often people will not be able to separate them. Panels have to be large enough. Caption clearly explains the plot. Rule of the thumb is that people caption should explain on the what is on the plot. Sometimes you say, please see text, but this is that require long explanation that the figure capture can handle. Usually, figure capture should stand by themselves. Scatter plots are sort like Rorschach's tests. Do not use them for quantitative conclusions. You really cannot read from them. You get the impression of what's going on. If you need three dimensions, go for Lego or whatever. Don't leave dots with a different concentration. Nobody will understand what you whether your conclusions are right or wrong, except very, very clear cases. And here again, like a few examples. As you can imagine, this is not very easy, and this is actually our start plot, which even got published. But as you see, your chart is terrible. It's not issue of aesthetic; it's issue of communication. You need 5 minutes to understand what is what. Number of and equations. All not counting numbers should have units. Give the correct number of significant figure. Make sure that all variables and acronyms are clearly defined, particularly abbreviations. When you read computing science papers, unless it is your 50 papers in the field, you will really get confused. The number of abbreviations are overwhelming. Reference.
Be generous with references.
Everyone has their own pet annoyance. Mine is people who do not discuss Star Harbor also do not reference the relevant hardware papers. Hardware is a vital part of the experiment, data taking, and at the end conclusions. Without proper hardware, hardware will be NF, and not referencing hardware and fantastic experts who built the detector we are using today is a crime. Lens, to misquote Einstein, a paper should be as short as possible but not shorter. When you are trying to squeeze 7 pages into 4 to go to PRL, clearly you lose your audience. You will make things uncomprehensive and understandable. Don't do it. You have to make an effort to cut out 6, not to squeeze them. This is very important. Paper should be as short as possible, but not shorter. It has to be clear and understandable, otherwise it's pointless. Lens. If you really want to get to PRL, paper which see your page limit, then cut some of the extraneous material or other exquisite language and comprehensive. We already talked about it. Stick to the shortest possible story, but told cleanly. And again, I have here examples which when you read it, you will have clear picture what I mean. Editing. Revise. Get comments from many people. Outside collaborators, outside people. Someone from the edge of the target audience is the best. For example, a new student who comes to your group who doesn't know much yet, learning process and on the learning curve, kind of relatively on the bottom. You will have a very good gauge how easy it is to follow your arguments. Take the comments seriously. If they don't understand, change the text so they do. Do not rationalize. They don't, they just don't understand. It is a very big chance that other people also want. Peer review process. Ask your colleagues for input, comments, suggestions. Peer review can provide very good feedback for authors. Take comments seriously. Very important. Take comments seriously. Don't do this, they don't understand. This is not rational, this is not acceptable. Have patience. If you ignore them now, they may show up during discussion or question-answer part of your talk or in the referee reports from journal on your paper. You can very easily avoid it if you are listening to the comments, critical comments. Peer review process. Besides improving the presentation paper, this will also improve relationship with your collaborators. A rule of thumb is to make request changes unless you have good reason not to do it. For complex comments, it is worth to iterate with the common authors. It's good to get to some common grounds. They don't understand something, maybe with your additional explanations, they can go through the process of following your arguments and be satisfied. Otherwise, you may make some small corrections that would be easier. It's very important, not because you care very much about upsetting this particular individual, but because it helps other people who read your paper. Conclusion. Preparing for a good presentation or good writing in general isn't easy, but it pays dividend in the number of people who will understand your work, read and appreciate your paper. Follow a simple storyline, keep your paper sentences structure simple, solicit a bunch of comments from many readers, and have patience. Have fun and good luck.
It's useful. I would expect a similar one given by Sora Tefika. Thank you very much. There are some short comments or questions? Yeah.
I just comments on answering referee reports were very useful. Second, my comments, though, that in my work as editor for PRD, in a small but non-zero fraction of the time, particularly with theory papers, one gets an irrational response to a good paper. And I just want to tell authors that if you find a very vitriolic response to your paper, that you should hopefully have faith in the judgment of the editors, that eventually a reasoned judgment will be done.
We usually argue, because if you have a good reason we usually write comments on comments, and very often it gets to the point that is resolved with a particular paper. Very often corrections are made, very often referee require that you provide some additional information, additional blog. Even if it doesn't go to the paper, it allows him or her to understand and to resolve. Very often if we see that it's totally black wall, we just withdraw it, make correction and submit again. We see that there's too many things to correct. I've never been in such a process yet, but I have heard that it is successful. In our case, I lost my voice. I submitted, they will require small and within a few days possible information. They wanted to know, for example, the recent one, they were concerned about the efficiency. We had few boards in TPC not functioning, and that was a dip in efficiency, and they wanted to understand the error of this collection. One number. So it was very simple and it was accepted. Usually people who are the editors take big care of sending this to the competent people. So I always think they are very good at this.
We do our best, but sometimes fail. I did think your comment that if you can make straightforward comments to the referee, whether or not you think it's useful to do it,
Absolutely. And again, be patient. Don't get annoyed. They have their points, even if you may not accept at the very moment, the very first moment. Try to understand why they worry about a particular aspect. Usually it pays off. We are submitting many papers. This BIM Manager Scan program, I am convener of this program, so it goes through my hands. We submit 16 papers for the last few years. We didn't get any single rejection. We really take good care for all concerns, and this is paying off.
Okay, some other questions? Okay, so thank you again.
Sure.
And now there's a turn of Rafka Tvare. Oh, you are here. Yeah, okay.
Break?
Sorry. After the break, there is a time for coffee, of course.